Hello friends, in the last occasion during the previous session, we all learned to understand what is all about competition, the shift from the MRTP Act to the Competition Act, the differences between the MRTP Act and the Competition Act. Keeping the background of my introduction to understanding the Competition Act, I will introduce you to the salient features of the Competition Act 2002. Before I get into the salient features, you need to understand how to begin reading a law. Any law, when it is enacted, seeks to address some mischief in the society. What is the mischief so far as the Competition Act is concerned? When I am saying mischief, what does the law try to achieve by enacting a particular act? An act is enacted for the purpose of addressing a mischief. I am laying emphasis on understanding mischief. You may ask me, what is a mischief? Mischief in the society is that we need to have free markets. We need to have a competitive environment where everybody's talent is exhibited. To allow that competition to be there, we need a regulation. Regulation comes in form of law. And for competition is concerned, the law that is governing or regulating competition is the Competition Act. To begin with, as I said, law seeks to address a mischief. To address the mischief in any society, any law that is made will be guided by three principles. Number one, first we need to define what is the mischief. You need to define what is anti-competition. You need to define what is the abuse of a dominant position. Once you define it, then you need to say, if you contravene the act which is considered mischief, what would the sanction be? So basically, there are three important principles. One, the definition. Two, definition of what is mischief, or to put it in simple sense, what is the wrong? What is the punishment that will be awarded if you do the wrong? To put it in a more simpler sense, there is a law. There is a breach, there is a sanction. Law, it says do something or don't do something. Then, if you do something wrong, which is not accepted by law, that tantamounts to a breach. Once there is a breach, if there is a breach, it is not sufficient. That breach, or called violation, should have some sanction from law. That sanction from law comes in form of penalties. So therefore, every law should have a teething for regulation. Teething comes through a penalty. Once there is a penalty, it will lead to a deterrent. And the deterrent has the force of law, which is why it becomes enforceable. Keeping this in mind, please be guided by the three principles I said. There shall be a law. If there is a breach, there shall be a penalty. To understand, the Competition Act also has been designed by adopting these three guiding forces. So how does a Competition Act basic structure look like? The Competition Act first defines what is an anti-competitive agreement. There's a definition specifically called agreements, but I'm going to get into definitions after I finish introducing you to the salient features of the Act. It says, what is an abuse of a dominant position? Students, you must note, the objective of the Competition Act is to address the mischief. Mischief, that is, anything adverse to a good competitive market. Now, this mischief will be addressed by this Act by laying down, as I said, what is the punishment, what is the law, and who is the regulator. These things are relevant. If you look at the salient features, it talks about definitions first, then it goes into creating a commission. You may ask me, what is a commission? A commission is some kind of a body. Naturally, like a question again comes to you, all right, a law has been made, who is the custodian of this law? Who is the one who is going to keep a watch whether this law is implemented or not? Then they constitute a body called the Competition Commission. Constituting a Competition Commission is not sufficient. It must also have certain powers. It should be entrusted with certain duties. It should also be told as to how it should function, who are its functionaries. All these questions are addressed in the law. When I am saying the law, please refer it to all throughout as the Competition Act. under the Competition Act. Now, once you constitute, see, Competition Commission can be seen something like a police, because in a simplest sense, everybody understands how police operates. Whenever there is a law and order violation, police comes into the picture. But within the framework of the Competition Act, whenever there is a violation, then the commission comes into the picture. Now, commission is being conferred certain powers. Those powers are, one, it has a power to adjudicate upon an issue that it found that there was a violation. Not just adjudication, but also award penalties and punishment. Like a police officer policing over or implementing the law, the Competition Commission also has been entrusted high responsibility under the Competition Act to ensure that the Act is implemented in its best sense. So far as the powers conferred upon the Commission, if you look at it, I said it has adjudicatory powers. Besides adjudicatory powers, it also has the power of reviewing its orders. It also has the power to the Act, I am not saying the powers of the Commission, but the Act also provides provision for an appeal and also provision for a reference. There will be a little confusion as to understanding what is adjudication of dispute, what is a review power, what is an appellate power, and what are the penalties issued. Because all of us will be always concerned, all right, there is a law, I violated the law, what is the punishment? It is crucial, as I said, a law which does not have a sanction. When I say sanction, it means a punishment. Such a law would be of no good. Keeping these guiding principles, the law very carefully deals with every aspect of it and lays down a strict legal regime regulating the Competition Act. Going forward, we shall see what is the main objective of the Act. We repeat, for the purpose of understanding it from the preamble of the Act. If you look at the preamble of the Act seeks to provide this. Whenever you want to understand the objectives, you should always make reference to the earlier introductory notes and also to the very objective of the Act, which is laid down in the preamble. The preamble reads as follows. The Act is enacted to provide for an economic development in the country, not just economic development. Now, economic development can happen when there is competition. Not just economic development, but also it seeks to establish a commission. I laid emphasis on commission. Commission to prevent certain practices having an adverse impact on competition. In addition to that, the Act also aims at promoting and ensuring there is good competition in the market. Not just competition in the market, but also ensuring that the interests of the consumers and the freedom of trade are carried out as best practices in India. Keeping these two objectives, it not only seeks to keep the competition, good competition in the market, but it also looks at the interests of the consumers and the traders at the same time. And all such matters that is associated with it, incidental to it, are dealt with under the Act. Now, these things are the basic objectives of the Act. Now, most of this points that I said have already been repeated in the introductory sessions. The same words are again recaptured in the preamble. You may ask me, why do we need so much of emphasis on understanding the preamble? I would say this. Whenever you want to understand the law, preamble becomes the key to unlock each and every provision captured under the Act. Preamble guides as to what each section should be interpreted, in what context it should be interpreted. Without understanding the preamble, you cannot understand the law because it lays down the objectives. Going forward, we need to understand how has this Act been structured. Now, structuring of the Act is as follows. The Act is divided into 9 chapters and 66 sections. Reason because it has to accommodate those principles that I said. What were those principles? First, definitions. When I say definition, defining a mischief. Creating a policing authority like the Competition Commission. 2, laying down the functioning, its powers, duties of the Competition Commission. 3, laying down the penalties and conferring certain delegated power under the Act to the Competition Commission. When I go into the Act of each chapter in detail, perhaps there will be a clarity as to understanding what each chapter is dealing with. The first chapter has sections 1 to 2, and the first section lays down what is the extent to which or to whom does it apply. We always must know when a law is made, who is being governed under the law. First section says the law applies to the entire state of India, excludes the state of Jammu and Kashmir. People may ask me, why exclude Jammu and Kashmir? Jammu and Kashmir, as you understand, it earns a special status, and the laws enacted for it are special and different from the manner in which the laws apply to the Union of India, excluding state of Jammu and Kashmir. The second section, as I said, is the definitions. Please be guided. Definitions are important for this act, because based on the definition itself, we'll understand what is anti-competitive, what is an agreement, where is the government. We get a basic understanding of definition of each thing. After that, you have chapter 2. Chapter 2 becomes very crucial, because chapter 2 lays down what are prohibitory agreements, what is an abuse of dominant position, what are combinations, and how are combinations regulated. Chapter 2 becomes a very important chapter. Chapter 2 is important because this chapter lays down all that is anti-competitive. You must keep in mind, it is this chapter that becomes the guiding force to decide what is anti-competitive in the market. If you look at important sections under chapter 2, section 3 talks about anti-competitive agreements. It prohibits anti-competitive agreements. Section 4 talks about abuse of dominant position. Section 5 talks about what is a combination. And section 6 lays down a regulation of combination. As you observed, chapter 2 becomes very, very important. As I said at the very outset of my session, that addressing a mischief becomes relevant. Now, it is this chapter that lays down what is a mischief. Mischief is talked about section 3, where it defines what is anti-competitive agreement. It talks about section 4, which talks about what is abuse of dominant position. Section 5, it talks about what are the combinations that can be anti-competitive. When you say combinations, you may be confused. Combinations means a group of people can get together, and for a objective which can have an adverse impact of on competition in the market. Section 6 becomes relevant because it seeks to lay down some sort of a regulation, because it speaks for itself. How do we regulate such combinations? Therefore, chapter 2 becomes very, very important and lays down all that is anti-competitive. Chapter 3. Now, chapter 3 becomes important. As I said, there has to be some authority, some body regulating or implementing the Competition Act. It is chapter 3 that talks about the Competition Commission of India. And under this chapter, section 7 talks about establishment of the commission. Section 8 talks about composition of the commission. You may ask me, composition. Composition also becomes relevant. Who are the people who are sitting on the board? Who are the people who are sitting in the commission? Section 9 talks about the selection of the committee of the persons and members of the commission. Section 10 lays down the term of the office and the chairperson of other members of the commission. As I said, when you're conferring a power upon somebody, you need to also define their tenure and term, which is the reason why chapter 3 is being carefully worded to ensure that the constitution of the commission is just not done, but it also lays down as to the tenure of each member and his qualifications. As you observe, section 11 of the chapter 3 talks about resignation, removal, and suspension of a chairperson and other members. This is also important. It's just not about selecting somebody, but he must also possess the right qualification. And if he's done a wrong, then he should also be removed. Section 12 in the same chapter deals with restriction on employment of chairperson and other members in certain cases. The chapter 3 primarily talks about the constitution or establishment of the Competition Commission of India and lays down various provisions relating to it. Section 13 talks about administrative powers of the Constitution Commission. Administrative powers are to be seen from a chairman's perspective. Section 14 lays down what is a salary payable. and what are the allowances payable to the members of the commission. Section 15 talks about vacancy. Vacancy is all about notification. Friends, please note, it is always the government when you're working, because government is a representative of the people. And whenever a recruitment to a high post is considered, it is done with certain transparency. And the transparency comes down only if the Act lays down the requisite qualifications and the term of continuing in the said post. Section 16 talks about Director General. I'm going to talk about role of Director General when I get into each chapter in detail in course of my next sessions. Section 17 talks about appointment of the secretary, experts, professionals, and officers and other employees of the commission. It's a quite a comprehensive chapter which primarily talks about constitution of the competition commission. Going on to chapter 4. Chapter 4 has sections 18 to 40. Now these 18 to 40 sections are important because it deals with duties, powers, and functions of the commission. As I said earlier in my very beginning of the session, establishment of a commission is not sufficient unless you confer certain duties, its powers, and what functions it shall discharge. If you look at section 18, section 18 lays down the duties of the commission. Section 19 talks about inquiry into certain agreements and dominant position of an enterprise. It is relevant to pay attention here. Section 19 becomes an important section because it confers a power of inquiry. As it speaks for itself, section 19 clearly says it's conferring power on the commission to inquire into certain agreements. Friends, note, in a business transaction, when these kind of inquiries is talked about, it looks into the manner in which you structure a business to bring about an anti-competitive regime to affect competition in market. Power of inquiry under section 19 is conferred upon the commission. Similarly, section 20 confers a similar power, inquiry into combinations by commission. All throughout, if you observe, there's an inquiry power conferred upon the competition commission under the guise of sections 19 and section 20. In addition to the inquiry power of the commission, under the Act, the commission has also been empowered to have a power to refer an issue. Similarly, in addition to the commission, a statutory authority has also been conferred a power to refer an anti-competitive issue to the commission. I'll come to both these sections when I touch this chapter once again in detail. Similarly, under the same chapter, it is also said as to how the commission should conduct its meeting. Certain sections such as 23, 24, 25 have been omitted with the amendment in 2007. They become relevant because those that have been repealed or amended also becomes relevant for the purpose of the Act, because when certain law has already been made but it stood repealed, it has some sort of an implication on the existing cases. Therefore, it is to be understood as to what sections have been amended or withdrawn or omitted. Section 26 under this chapter lays down the procedure for inquiry under section 19. Now, this is also very, very important. You may ask me, inquiry, power of inquiry has been conferred upon the commission. Does it mean the inquiry can be conducted in its own way, in an arbitrary manner? No. It is section 26 that lays down certain procedure. It is important under law, whenever you confer a power of inquiry upon any authority, that inquiry also should be guided by a judicious principle in the form of a law. Similarly, if you look at section 27 of the chapter, it states what are the orders that can be passed by commission after conducting an inquiry into the issues which it found to be anti-competitive or on issues relating to abuse of dominant position. Friends, please note, this chapter is important because it is conferring certain investigative powers. I am saying inquiry. The difference between enquiry and inquiry. Inquiry is more of investigative nature. Investigation also as to how it should be done is conferred upon the commission. In addition to not only conferring its power of inquiry, it's also saying if it is found that there is an anti-competitive element, then what sort of orders can the commission pass? Section 27 lays down as to what orders can be passed by the commission. Section 28 talks about division of enterprises enjoying dominant position. If you look at Section 28, it is conferring certain power on the commission where some cartels, most of you may understand term cartel, it comes very often in the competition regime. Cartels are a group of individuals who would get together and form a monopoly in market and try to dictate the price or rule the market. Now, if such cartels are found, commission also has the power to break such cartels. I am putting it in a very simplest sense to understand what is the statute trying to do under the Act. Section 28 deals with this. Section 29 lays down a procedure for investigation of combinations, because combinations are kind of cartels which have to be regulated, and procedure for investigation is laid down under Section 29. Very interesting aspect. If you observe, there is a procedure which was prescribed as to how an inquiry should be conducted when you want to deal with certain anti-competitive agreement and when there is a dominant position abused. You saw that under Section 19, power of Section 19, and similar power it used observed at Section 26, the procedure dealing with the inquiry part. If you look at here, under 29, there is a procedure laid down for understanding the investigation of combinations. Now, combinations I discussed earlier. To address all those combinations that will be anti-competitive, an investigation process and a procedure is laid down in Section 29. Moving forward, Section 30 lays down the procedure in case a notice under subsection 2 of Section 6 is issued. Section 6, note friends, as I said, falls under Chapter 2. It talks about regulation of combination. These have a relation. Regulation of combination, how to issue a notice when you want to regulate a combination, is seen under Section 30. You bear this in mind and read Section 30 along with Section 6 of Chapter 2. After that, you have Section 31, which talks about orders of the Commission on certain combinations. If you observe the chapter, it talks about various things. It talks about inquiry. It talks about as to how the inquiry should be conducted. It lays down the procedure for inquiry. It says if the inquiry is conducted, then what is the order to be passed. Similarly, in a combination issue also, it lays down the procedure as to how to investigate in a combination. It lays down the procedure as to how to issue a notice when you are dealing with a Section 6 issue, which is regulation of combination. It also lays down as to what orders can be passed in certain combination. Orders to be passed into certain combination is seen under Section 31. This chapter is very carefully constructed without mixing any of the issue that has to be dealt under the Act. It's very carefully structured even for the purpose of understanding it also. Moving on to Section 32. Section 32 talks about certain acts that take place outside India but having an effect on the competition in India. See, this is the line of the section speaks for itself. Any activity that happens over shores, which is outside the limit of India, but has an impact on the competition of Indian market, would be dealt with under the Act. This is an interesting feature of the Act, which deals with market as a whole, which is a universal kind of a market, at the same time seek a protectionist kind of a regime for the Indian environment. This section is also a very important section which has to be examined. Section 33 confers the powers to issue interim orders. The term interim becomes relevant. Most of you will understand what is an order. Interim means temporary. Whenever you file a petition or grievance application before the commission and you seek certain prayer, you say, let there be a direction on certain aspect. That is your main relief. But pending it, you need to prevent the issue from continuing further. Therefore, you can request the commission to confer, to give an interim order pending your main relief. So, interim order is a temporary relief where you can ask under the Act from the commission. Unless such a power is conferred upon the commission, it cannot grant you an interim order. Now, in form of a statute, under Section 33, the powers of interim order is conferred upon the commission. 34 section stood omitted in the amendment of 2007. 35 talks about, is also a very important section. It talks about appearance before commission. As I said, sometimes there are notices affected on people who are accused of indulging in anti-competitive activities. In such case, the commission directs appearances. Now, how the appearance procedure is governed is laid down under section 35. Moving on to section 36. 36 talks about power of the commission to regulate its own procedure. Now, this is an interesting feature, which is a delegated power, kind of a delegated legislation given to the commission to lay down its own procedure to implement the act. This is also a very important section. Section 36 also has to be examined to understand perspective of the powers conferred upon the commission. Section 37, stood omitted in the year 2007, does not become relevant so far as the current day application is concerned. Section 38 talks about rectification of orders. Now, the question comes here. There is an order, there is a power to pass an interim order, and sometimes you may ask me, why should there be rectification of order? Most a very often raised question. A judge is supposed to pass an order very carefully, but what happens if he commits a typographical error? Should he not be conferred certain power to rectify his orders to ensure that the order is in tandem with the wisdom that he laid down? For that purpose, section 38 confers a power upon the commission to rectify its orders. Moving on to section 39, execution of the orders of the commission imposing monetary penalty. As the section speaks for itself, we call it the execution proceedings. If you see section 39, it clearly lays down an order passed by the commission, assuming it passes an order against an anti-competitive agreement or seen an abuse of a dominant position under section 27, or it passes an order under section 31. In both the cases, if you want to implement such an order, there should be power to implement the order also. It means under this chapter, there is power conferred upon the commission to not only pass an order, but also see to that it is implemented. It's guided by this principle. Justice must not just be done, but it must be seen to be done. And that becomes relevant. So this principle is clearly reflecting in form of the sections captured under chapter 4. Moving on to chapter 5. Chapter 5 just has one section, section 41, and it talks about duties of the Director General. This is quite a comprehensive section. It confers certain special powers upon the Director General to investigate into contravention. The catchword here is contravention and investigation. Whenever there is a contravention of the act, then the powers of the Director General are laid down under this chapter. Since in this session we've covered chapters 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, I will cover the rest of the chapters, that is 6, 7, 8 and 9 in the next session. For the purpose of recap, please understand, as I said at the very outset of my session, that the five chapters I just discussed clarify what is the mischief that the Competition Act seeks to address and who is its custodian or implementer in form of the Competition Commission, the powers of the Competition Commission, its duties, and special powers of the Director General when there is a contravention of the Act.